Welcome to the Cincy Corner, the place where Ohio sports meets sports betting. The Cincy Corner is brought to you by the U.S. Gambler and sponsored by Betfred Sportsbook. Betfred provides the most personalized betting experience on the market, from in-person events with betting competitions, weekly promotional offers that fit your betting size and patterns, as well as the personal touch you won't get anywhere else. Betfred gives you more. And this is the Cincy Corner, and I'm here with my beloved co-host, Kyle Hunter. How's it going?
It's going great, man. Looking forward to a big Bengals game here on Thursday night.
That's right, man. Me too. But before that, I got a surprise. Our next guest has more jobs than Ryan Seacrest. She works for Kiss107, in-game host for the Cincinnati Bearcats. She covers Bengals, Reds, and even Skyline Chili. It's the multi-threat, Sara Elyse.
Hi.
Hello. How's it going?
I have a lot of jobs, but one of them is not being good with, like, getting my camera set. So, to that, technical difficulties, that's something that we all understand, right?
Yeah, no doubt about it. So, you know, question right out of the gate, how'd you get involved with every single Cincinnati sports on the planet?
I don't know, man. It's all just been kind of like a work in progress over time. I have a background in journalism. I graduated from Miami a long time ago. And then I've just kind of worked out my way from there, starting with iHeartMedia. I've been there for over 3 years now. And then the jobs just kind of piled on there, honestly. So I'm a little busy right now, but I love it. And I love that all the sports are overlapping, like whether it's baseball, high school football, pro football. And then we got Cyclones coming up next month. And it's just a great time of the year, really.
With being on regular radio, do they ever get upset with anything you do on social media? Like, do you have to watch anything there?
Yeah, I have to be careful. There are a few times where, like, my news director will be like, hey, can you take that tweet down? I won't think it's a problem, but, you know, I do have to be careful with my social media. Like, it is my own account, but there is a certain standard there that I do have to follow. So, you know, I can't be cussing on there. Nothing like that.
What about, so which team do you feel closer with, the Bengals or the Reds covering them?
I mean, the Reds, there are so many games and I watch them pretty much every single night. I mean, sadly, they're chasing 100 losses right now. They just got loss number 96 of the season. They have a couple in Chicago this weekend, and next week they'll be back here playing Chicago again. So I'm like, can they be historically bad this season? So unfortunately, like, I am the closest to them. It's not a good season for us, though, as everybody knows it. We might be struggling for the next couple of years. But yeah, definitely Reds, Bengals, Bearcats. I work for them as well. I love covering them. And then again, our Cyclones are starting up next month, so I can't wait to see what they do on the ice this season.
Quick question for you here, Sara. Let's start with the Reds. And I feel like I want to have like a glass half full, at least a little bit, because, you know, like you said, it's been a rough season for sure. I've been a Reds fan for a long time. What kind of positives can you take out of a season like this, right? So maybe the improved depth in the minor leagues. I know Ellie De La Cruz is somebody that people are really looking forward to seeing in future years. And the trades, they kind of beefed up the minor league system. But do you have any positives coming out of this year for the Reds?
Positives on the field, I like what I'm seeing from guys like Hunter Green and Graham Ashcroft. I mean, I don't know if you watched Hunter Green last night, but he looked complete fire on the mound. And I'm expecting to see a lot of great from him over the next few years, you know, again, with Graham Ashcroft and guys like Nick Lodolo. I love what we're seeing off the field from guys like Joey Votto and Tyler Steele. They're on the IL right now, but they're still staying so close to the team, whether they're hanging out in the radio or TV booth, or they're, two of them are hanging out together. Like, they're going to be going apparently to the Moeller football game on Friday night together, and they're going to be hanging out on the sidelines and showing their support for high school football. I mean, they've been going to local restaurants and hanging out at the zoo. And I mean, Joey Votto last week was walking around the stadium and taking selfies with fans. Like, it's that kind of stuff where it's like, it still shows that the players, they do care, and they're still just trying to have fun and make the most of a season that's not been ideal. So those are two perspectives to take away. And then again, our rookie of the year, Jonathan India, he dealt with a lot of injuries this season, as we all saw. Hopefully he can be healthy next year and we'll get a much better performance from him moving forward, starting with spring training. And then, you know, our guys, Tyler and Joey, they'll be back from the IL and hopefully ready to go for spring training as well. But I'm definitely feeling more optimistic about next season moving forward.
Yeah, I want to piggyback on what you said there too. Joey Votto, just a great face of the franchise. Much fun. Love it that he was just going from spot to spot, taking videos and pictures with people and stuff. And then how awesome has he been in the booth too? I mean, just tremendous. I mean, he has a future career in the booth if he wants one, for sure. Just a great guy to be the face of the franchise, for sure.
I agree. And it's like, I don't even know the Reds without Joey Votto. He's been with the team for his whole career, 20 seasons? So thinking of him without the team is just, it's devastating, honestly. So I hope that he does stay close, whether that is a place in the radio or the TV booth. I mean, I don't know, Sadak and Larkin, they seem like they love having him in there. I know he'll be back next week working with them. So who knows, there might be a place with him on Bally Sports.
Yeah, absolutely. Hopefully he has a nice bounce back season next year as well, too, because he had an amazing season last year. Great, great season. He's an all-time great hitter, for sure.
Yeah, I think he had one streak where he hit like seven games in a row where he was hitting bombs. And then, I mean, unfortunately, this season with the torn rotator cuff and being on the IL and having to, you know, deal with that, you could tell he was in pain, and that's why his swing wasn't looking the same. I mean, even the guys in the booth were like, what's going on with his swing? It looks different. And we were all noticing that. And Joey's like, all right, I guess I should go take care of this. But yeah, with only having 1 year left on his contract, who knows what the future is going to look like for him. But yeah, again, hopefully he can go out, you know, successfully.
Absolutely.
Does it feel a little bit different, like loving the Reds, knowing that they won a championship in the past, compared to the Bengals, who haven't done it yet? Is there like a little sense of like security? It's like, well, you know, we haven't won it this year. We're taking a beating, but at least we, you know, got all these championships in the past. Does that make it a little bit different?
I think there's a lot of respect there, especially from the older generation. And, you know, I got the love for the Reds from my dad and my grandpa, and the same with the Bengals. My dad and grandpa both were season ticket holders. My grandpa passed away earlier this year, but my dad, you know, him and I still go to a lot of games together. We'll be going to New Orleans together to see them play the Saints. So I'm looking forward to that. But I just think that there's a lot of respect there still for baseball. I mean, you look around and everyone's still very dedicated. They've got their headsets in listening to Tommy and Cowboy in the booth. And I mean, I don't know. It's like you love them through the thick and the thin, through the better for worse. It's kind of like a marriage. And I'm like, I'm a Reds fan no matter what. But I do think that there's a whole new respect for the Bengals. I mean, a respect that we have not seen in the city for quite some time. So I think people are still on that Bengals high right now. And
letting your kid love the Bengals in the 90s was like child abuse, you know, but we made it through it. It was tough times.
Yeah, my dad, he was always tough on me. Like, no matter if they're down by 3 touchdowns in the fourth quarter, like, we're sticking it out no matter what. You never know what could happen. We never left games early. And so I always got that mentality, like going to a Reds or Bengals game, like never leave early, guys. You just don't know what happened with these guys.
So all these years of covering, are there any covering all these Cincinnati teams? Is there any stories of the best or the worst Cincinnati athlete?
It was really cool covering the rally. At the time it was Paul Brown Stadium, right before the guys went to the Super Bowl. Do you all remember that, like the rally that was held at the stadium? It was like the week leading up to the Super Bowl.
Yeah, last year, right?
Yeah, Bengal Jim hosted it along with the comedian.
Yeah, yeah. Burrow looked like Elvis coming out.
Yeah, they're all in their white tracksuits. I think that was like a big career highlight for me, and seeing all the guys up close and seeing how excited they were to see all the fans there for them. And they just know how important it is to the city for them to win like that. And I mean, I got to meet Evan McPherson that night, and he was just so sweet. I had a really good conversation with him on the field, just while all the, you know, events were taking place in front of us. Super nice kid. I mean, what is he, 23 years old? He's definitely—
He looks 12.
He does. Like, I'm like 5'8", and I don't think he came up to me right there. So I was like, oh my gosh, he's just a kid. And then being there for opening day this season and watching Joe Burrow and Zach Taylor warm up before throwing out the first pitch together, just staying there, throwing the ball back and forth. That was just a cool exchange to be a part of, and kind of photograph that and get some video and watching those two interact together. And then it was also interesting because Joey Votto walked up to Joe Burrow and said, hey man, you want to go make a TikTok video together? And it never ended up happening. I don't know what the exchange was once they left together. But I did hear Joey Votto ask Joe Burrow to make a TikTok video with him. So I thought that was really funny.
What'd you think of that call? The whole, you know, the call in the Super Bowl. What?
I don't even want to talk about that.
I'm sorry. I was still hoping something. Congress is still working on something.
We were under. It was like not even 2 minutes to go of being Super Bowl champions. And
it was crazy. I lived my whole life waiting for that Super Bowl. And I just couldn't picture my life with a Bengals Super Bowl win. You know what I mean? So I was like, here we go. But I don't know.
And by just what you've seen so far, I mean, we're only three games in, but do you think that these guys have a shot at going back to the Super Bowl this season?
I mean, for me, it's always tough to repeat and go back because, you know, you got the target on your back now instead of being the underdog. I think they certainly have the talent to do it. And I think that they have the willpower. I mean, this is not a team that's just going to not care just because they came up short. I think that even in these losses, they keep fighting. You know, we saw them do that against the Steelers. It would have been easy for them to quit. You know, that would have been an easy game to lose by 17 points. I like their fight. I think there's a lot of good teams in the AFC, so I don't think it'll be easy. You know, the Bills, the Chiefs, there's a lot of really good teams, the Ravens. I think they'll get back there again, whether it'll be this year or not. I sure hope so.
Full disclosure, I have a Bengal disorder. All right. So with that being said, the whole story of Joe Burrow has been amazing from start to finish. And it was almost too perfect. If he would have hit that touchdown to Chase last year, it would have been too perfect. Right. So this makes it a little bit sweeter when they win it this year. So yeah, I think they will get there. I think they're going to win the Super Bowl this year. I do.
I love the optimism because I don't hear from a whole lot of optimistic people like after the team comes out and, you know, loses two in a row. So I love that I'm talking to people that are actually optimistic. Like, yeah, they have a shot at this. They could go 15-2 still.
But to be fair, in 2000, when they were 0-8, I think I said John Kitna would still lead them back the rest of the way and get a wild card, win the Super Bowl. So throw that out there.
Wait. You didn't have to say that part. I mean,
I'm sorry. You're right.
No, I mean, but look, there's a lot to be optimistic about as a Bengals fan. And it's easy to see 0-2 and two tough losses and think the world's falling apart. But I remember Bengals Jim said last week, you know, you have to be, even if you're going to lose two games, 0-2, you still have a chance to go 15-2. So, you know, that's the kind of mindset we like to have.
And that's a great mindset moving forward, especially heading into such a big game tomorrow night.
What do you expect to see for the game tomorrow?
What is my score prediction?
Yeah, like break down the game a little bit. Like what do you expect to see?
Oh, my gosh. I'm hoping to see a lot of action between, you know, Burrow to Chase, Burrow to Mixon. A lot of stuff from T again. He had a great, you know, great game last weekend. I'm taking the Bengals 28-21 tomorrow.
Yeah, I'm liking the Bengals too. I think that that game, I was checking it out last week, Buffalo and Miami, and it was such a back and forth and 100-degree heat. And, you know, it was just brutal on them. And I think emotionally and physically just draining. I like the Bengals tomorrow.
Yeah, and I think like Miami, you know, they took advantage of the Bills having some guys on the, you know, on the injury list. So I think that kind of worked to their advantage for sure.
Yeah, it definitely did. You know, looking at that game last week, Miami's defense was on the field for 90 plays. I mean, 90 plays in 100-degree heat is really something. And the Dolphins come off a game where they were outgained 495 to 212, and they still won the game. That's really hard to do. The other team has more than double the yards of you, and you still win. You know, the only thing I will say is everybody's betting on the Bengals here in this game. You know, it's been the Bengals were -1.5. Now they're up to -4. I hope everybody's right. I do think the Bengals will win this game. I'm getting a little bit worried if I was betting this game to lay more than a field goal because it should be a pretty close game, I would think. But a short turnaround game makes it difficult for this Miami team who, let's be honest, we should also mention that Tua, I mean, what's the deal with Tua, right? I mean, he has a quote-unquote back injury, and that's why he was stumbling around the field. I mean, strangest back injury I've ever seen for sure. But I don't know. Tua has looked good in this offense. The Dolphins are 3-0, but that makes this a really big game for the Bengals. I think it's a great opportunity for them after a slow start. So I'm going to agree with you guys that they bounce back here, have a nice win. The Dolphins are also last in special teams grade so far this year. So in those close games, special teams can make a big difference, certainly.
Exactly. It all comes down to that. As the Bengals have lost, it's only been by 3 points. So hopefully it's a great game tomorrow. It's a close game. I'm not lying on the floor in the suite tomorrow in disappointment and throwing chicken tenders around. We're going to see a good one tomorrow.
I got one last question for you, then we'll wrap this bad boy up, right? Are you aware of what you have in common with Terry Bradshaw and the late Norm MacDonald?
Oh, my gosh. I have no idea.
You guys are all lovers of dachshund and dogs.
Oh, she's sleeping right now. I should have brought her in.
Well, hey, thanks a lot for coming on the show. I really appreciate it. Tomorrow, I'll buy all your drinks for you. I'll pick it up, whatever you want to eat. It's on me. Don't worry about it. And then good luck on all the great things you're working on. And hoo-day.
Thank you so much. Everybody come out to Moraline. That's where I'll be hosting my tailgate tomorrow from 4:30 until 8 o'clock. Hoo-day, baby.
Let's go.
Thanks, Sarah.
So we touched on the Bengals a little bit with Sarah, but I'd like to go back to our big win against the Jets last week. I thought that was it felt so good just to get back on the right path. Everything was firing off. You could see, Joe quick striking. He only was sacked 2 times, which compared to the other weeks was basically nothing. And it was great seeing Tyler Boyd in action, the defense being dominant. Obviously, DJ Reader was a huge loss, man.
Huge loss, DJ Reader. He's been the best defensive tackle you could get in the NFL. It's hard to replace him. The Bengals do have a good defense in general, and I'm confident they can still do a good job. Hopefully he comes back, though, completely healthy here this year, because we're going to need him for a playoff run, certainly. As far as getting on the right path, it was nice to see the Bengals start out really strong, right? Because before they'd been down 17-3 in both of those games. It's nice to play from the lead and be able to be a little bit more cautious later in the game if you want to, instead of, being in a tough spot and the other team knowing that you're going to have to throw the ball every time. That also helps them with the pass rush. So I thought we saw a little bit more fire out of Joe Burrow early in that game too last week. Yeah, when they got a couple of those touchdowns, he was pretty fired up. I like to see that. Usually he's a really cool customer, but I think he knew that it was the right time to fire those guys up, that they really needed that win. And I know it was just the Jets, but the Jets had beaten Cleveland in Cleveland, and it was still nice to go into New York and sound win. It was never really a question of whether they were going to win that one.
I thought the Jets played pretty tough, though. And I'll tell you what I do not understand, and I never heard of this rule before, was T. Higgins' touchdown.
Oh, gosh.
I was like, what? They said his heels were facing the wrong direction.
That's crazy.
Yeah, that is crazy.
I mean, it's like his heels were going to come down out of bounds, So it's like, but they didn't actually come down. And that was an amazing catch, man. That was like the catch of the week in the NFL.
Yeah.
Higgins just balled out in that game. Also,
I spilled my beer. I couldn't believe it, man. It was unbelievable.
how about the dirty hit that Higgins took as well? I mean, Higgins has been playing really well. A lot of people forget that the Bengals have two really good receivers, and Boyd's good as well. But I know Chase gets a lot of the publicity, and he should. But Higgins is a really top-notch wide receiver as well.
I think he's right up there with him. I'm worried about them two weeks in a row, though. It seems like he's had some pretty major hits,
Yeah.
Which is kind of weird that we can talk about this, go right into the Miami game, is Tua. You touched on it for a second, but that's the craziest back injury I've ever seen.
Oh, man. So now we find out that he has a back and what is it, a back and an ankle injury or something? I guess that's why he was stumbling all over the place. I mean, just – frankly, I like Tua. He seems like a likable guy, and I don't, I don't want him to have success against the Bengals, but in general, I don't want to root against him. And I hated to see him stumbling around, and then he's back on the field in no time. Very strange, 100 degree heat. There he comes back out like nothing's wrong. I don't know. I know that there's some investigations going on into it, and Frankly, that can't be helping Miami. I mean, that's that kind of news is not helpful going into a big game on a short week.
That win, I was watching some of that game, and those guys were just spent. I just haven't seen a game like that in a long time where guys were just falling out left and right. So you, when you couple that in with the emotions, with now it's been a week where it has been a little bit cloudy. It was the first time I've seen McDaniels take a little bit of heat, you know, for all this stuff. And it just doesn't add up for a good week for them, you know. But that line, though, the way it's been jumping, it's just making me nervous.
Yeah, man. You know, I think that the people who hammered this line at -1.5 on the Bengals earlier in the week, it was a really good line grab. And I do want to say, remember last week we had Bengals Jim on, and he said, man, bet the Bengals here going into this one. That was a good bet. That ended up being one of my premium plays on Sunday, too, with the Bengals. And really, that was a comfortable win there with the Bengals as they went from -4.5 all the way up to 6. And then just covered the spread very easily there against the Jets. So hopefully the line move in this one is indicative of what's going to happen again here. This is a spot where the home team I know has done well. I'm trying to pull this up ATS wise. So keep talking here, man. But this is Thursday night's good for the home team on a short week. And now you have the Dolphins coming off, like I said, 90 plays on defense in that one. I mean, that's intense in the heat. They come in here, they're 3-0, they're riding as high as could be, beating the Buffalo Bills, the Super Bowl favorites, you know, and yet sharp bettors in the betting marketplace are taking the Bengals in a big way. I think that says quite a bit.
Yeah, it's just, it could be one of those that runs away from Miami where it's just like ugly quick. You know, because I know the city is going to be electric. I can't think of a game that was a regular season game that has had this much anticipation and excitement. I know that, you know, Big Willie Anderson's been in town and a bunch of ex-Bengals, they're going, you know, the Bengal gym at a tailgate, them guys were at it, or he had an event. I mean, so the ex-players are all around town, the whole town's just going crazy, and I think you're going to be able to see that electricity on the field tomorrow night. I can't wait.
All right, I got a stat here for you now. Looking this one up here in the lab as we talk, 80-63 against the spread, the last 143 on favorites on Thursday in the NFL. So this would include a couple of the, you know, like the Thanksgiving games that are on Thursdays. So home favorites on Thursdays have done really well. This is 56% against the spread. And hey, 56% against the spread, if you're hitting 56% long-term, you're doing really good. So home favorites on Thursdays have done well. The Bengals are in that role here. Let's hope it continues for another game. You know, the only other thing I had to say about this one is I think it's a bit underrated. We've been talking about this. I haven't heard enough people talk about the Bengals defense has been really good. And this defense has played exceptionally well, especially in the second half of these games. I don't think they've given up a second half touchdown this year. You know, this is a tremendous job by them. Without Reader, it's going to be a little bit tougher. Logan Wilson's played really good every game. I think the secondary, Awuzie, played very well last week. This Bengals defense, I like the coaching staff that they have under them, that they're being coached by. I think that they are really prepared for these games very well. And we have a little bit of extra flair coming into this one because of the Tyreek Hill, Eli Apple thing, right? So this is, and then Tua comes out today and says, well, anytime I see him with Eli Apple, I'm throwing the ball to him. You know, and that's the, and it's like, okay, so, you know, maybe the Bengals will bait him into a bad throw at some point. That's what kind of what I'm hoping. And Trey Hendrickson deserves a shout out too for last week. I mean, tremendous stuff. Those first couple games, he was not as good as he was some of the time last year, but he had the highest grade on PFF last week of anybody on defense. And then he won Defensive Player of the Week in the AFC, and it was well-deserved.
Yeah, and one thing, and in this day and age, at least for the next few weeks, there's not too many teams that do the old ground and pound, you know? So DJ Reader, I mean, he's a treasure for the team. I'm just saying, like, it might not kill us as much as it would in the playoffs as well. If he can come back for the playoffs, I think we'll be all right, you know? But, you know, one more factor is, you think about this, you know, if you're traveling for work and your house is about to blow down, that has to be a little bit of a distraction as well, you know? So absolutely, that hurricane's going to be tearing things up. I don't know. It's just a lot working against Miami tomorrow.
Yeah, there is. And I like to set up for the Bengals. Now they just need to take advantage of that opportunity and get back to 2-2. And I think this is a good chance for them. I think they'll show up with great effort here.
So coming off of Thursday night, since we're on Thursday nights, with the Browns, they won last week against Pittsburgh, which actually helped us out for the division because that dropped the Steelers down. So they lost one. We can still play the Browns twice. Browns going to Atlanta. I'm thinking, you know, I was looking at Atlanta, watching some of their game, and Mariota is always Mariota. He still looks like a college quarterback to me. You know, they got some cute little gadget plays, and Cordell looks pretty good. And of course, Pitts, but I think Cleveland's going to ground and pound and win that one.
You know, I think Atlanta's offense has been better than I expected so far this year. 5.9 yards per play, ninth best in the NFL. Atlanta's defense is not good at all. You know, the Atlanta home angle here, it's being played in a dome. So, you know, this is helpful for an over. In fact, Bengals genius, here's our alert for the system of the week. I'm going to have one of these coming up. I need some kind of like horn or something like that so that there can be the but we've got these early season totals. This is a system of the week or an angle that I feel like is going to be helpful to sports bettors. Early season totals, September, October, in a game in a dome. This one clearly fits. The over is 55.7% in the last 10 years. When the total is 50.5 or lower. I would bet the over if I was betting a total on this one. I think that's my favorite bet in this game.
What's the Betfred line right now?
The Betfred line right now on the total is 48.5. So we're under a key number of 49. I would want to grab it there. I think it could go above that 49. So as we record this, that's the live line here on Wednesday night, 48.5. I think it might go up. So if you see this and you want to take the over, I think you might want to grab that one because I think that will go up. As far as the side, I think the side right now being the Browns just by 1.5 is a little surprising to me. I think Mariota has played pretty well. He does have a lot of weapons around him. Let's be fair. You know, he has some pretty good guys to throw the football to, but the Browns defensive line is good. We know they have some injuries. Who knows about Garrett, you know, what his status is going to be here, but the Browns offense, I think, like you said, can run the ball on just about anybody, hopefully not the Bengals later this year. But I think this could be an over, and if I was taking a side, I'd take the Browns.
Yeah, I agree with you on that one. A huge matchup, too, the Ravens and Bills. Right now, Betfred line for that is Bills -3, with the over and under 51.
So this one is possible to be affected by the hurricane remnants. I've been keeping an eye on the weather in this one. I just am insane line moves in college football and the NFL has seen some line moves. 51 is clearly too low if this was a good weather game for these two teams. The Bills are too good of an offense. The Ravens defense hasn't been that good. But Bengals genius, I think you know this. Lamar Jackson has been amazing so far this year. If you look at PFF ratings, he's number one by a lot. Like nobody else even close as far as offensive players. You know, I think he's been the best player in the NFL offensively so far this year. The Ravens very banged up again this year. They have injury issues consistently. And the Ravens rank second last in tackling grade in the NFL at PFF. So only Seattle's been worse. You don't want to be with Seattle this year in the NFL, certainly. Showers throughout the day, winds of 15 or 20 miles per hour. That's why we've seen this total drop here. I think given normal weather, I would want to bet the over in this game. Given the weather that is expected here, tricky to bet a total. I got nothing really strong on this one, man. So I'm kind of hoping you have a lean on this one. I'm rooting for the Bills because, you know, we're rooting against a team in the Bengals division, in my opinion. So, you know, I'm rooting for the Bills here in this one, but I don't really have any strong opinion here. What do you think of this one?
I'm definitely leaning on the under, and I'll get more in depth on that. This is one of the ones I love for the week. So I'll go in depth later on this one. But we do want to touch on the Steelers and Jets. Honestly, I was thinking about this. You know, I feel like the Jets were talent-wise more skilled than the Steelers and the Dallas Cowboys. I thought they really played hard. Dallas, I don't know, but for sure the Steelers. So this game is going to be a toss-up. It could go either way. I don't have a leaning towards this one. This seems like push city to me.
Yeah, I was going to disagree with Dallas. I think Dallas has more talent than they do, but Steelers, I think that's fair. I think that the Jets, I think this is going to be Zach Wilson playing here at quarterback, which really, I don't know if that's a good thing or a bad thing. Flacco really hadn't played too bad. And, Wilson is a big unknown. The Steelers, the Steelers are well-coached. We've talked about that before, but the Steelers aren't very good. They haven't played really, they shouldn't have beat the Bengals either, but we won't get too much into that one. And then, the way they played against the Browns was not, all that impressive to me. Trubisky is Trubisky. I don't know that it's just his fault, though. The offensive coordinator, their plays don't seem very good to me. They don't seem very innovative. So the Steelers are a tough-minded team. Laying points with the Steelers, not something I'm too interested in doing.
Yeah, I'm going to stay away from this one as well.
All right, guys. So now you have a chance to get tickets to the Betfred Suite to a Bengals game. Man, this is clutch. It's amazing stuff. And you have a shot to do it yourself. You can go to theusgambler.com/Ohio, pre-register for Betfred over there at theusgambler.com. You'll be entered into a drawing for tickets to the Betfred Suite. Man, it is clutch. It's a lot of fun. Definitely want to get in on that one.
All right, then we're going to roll into our next segment. I love this one. It's Sports Betting 101. Now, Kyle, you're a legit professional gambler, okay? And I want you to explain this to me like I'm Forrest Gump and you're my mama, okay? Today's topic is teasers. Go ahead. I'm ready.
All right. So first, I like to consider it investing, sports investing, because this is investment still. Gambling is like, slot machines and stuff like that. We're investing in our future here. We can make money on this. So teasers, what are teasers? That's what we're going to talk about today. We're going to talk about what are teasers, where can you have success in them, and where should you avoid teasers? First, a teaser is really a type of parlay bet. Parlays, most people know what that is. Both, all bets have to win or at least push, and it reduces the winnings if you tie. So in a teaser, you get to move the point spread or total a certain amount of points in your favor. So a two-team six-point teaser is common in the NFL. You can also do 6.5 or 7 points. You just pay more juice. So if you want to take the minus 125, minus 130, some people also like three-team teasers that move at 10 points. I like to do the two teams because three teams, usually, one screwy thing can happen in one game that can really mess you up. But certain types of teasers can be really profitable long-term in the NFL. Betting sides through the key numbers of 7 and 3, really, really profitable. A lot of people have made great money on this in the past.
What do you mean by betting sides of those key numbers?
What I'm saying is if you take a team that's -8 and you tease them down to -2, you're blowing right through the 7, you're blowing right through the 3, down to the key number, through those key numbers of just to 2. Obviously, you could get some random game that finishes at 1 or 2, but usually it's going to be 3 or 4 or 7, something like that. Or if you want to take it the other way, a side or an against the spread bet, you can also tease up from, say, 1.5 to 7.5 or something like that. Those games are really important to try to put in those teasers. And the other thing you want to look for, man, is you want to look for these games with low totals, because why would you want to put one in that has a total of 60 or 58 when you could put one in that has a total of 39 or 42 or something like that? Points are going to be at a premium.
What constitutes a low total?
Low total, I mean, NFL so far this year has been a little bit lower than it has been in recent years, but a low total to me in the NFL is, 45 or lower, something like that. 47, 48 is more a normal total. And then once you get up to 49, 50, you're getting up in the pretty high total range. I'm not saying I would never bet a teaser in the NFL in a game with a higher total. I'm just saying the ultimate best spot to take a teaser is a low totaled game. And I just want to say for everybody listening, absolutely no teasers on college sports. It's just a really bad idea. There's way too much variance. Variance is it. When is your variance your friend? It's when you take some massive money line underdog, right? So you want to take this big money line underdog. You know, they could either lose by 30 points or they could win outright. That's awesome. If you take a teaser and you tease at 6 points and you're teasing a total or something like that, you got no chance long term. You're teasing totals. College football, college basketball, really, I think teasing totals in the NFL is also pretty dangerous because you go into overtime, there could be a lot of points scored in overtime. How much do you think that extra 5 or 6 points is going to matter if you're in college football and it goes into 3 or 4 overtimes? You know, it's like, well, oh, that's great. That under would have cashed, but now they scored 30 points more than what they would have, you know. So at that point, your teasers burn anyway. So teasers, you need to play them very carefully. If you go about it the right way, you can make money with teasers in the NFL. We will talk about teasers quite a bit on here. I'll give some teaser plays. I think I'll be able to get Bengals Genius to be given some teasers plays as well here. And, you know, just be really careful with those because I will tell you, most people lose betting teasers. I mean, these are really dangerous. You would be shocked how many questions I get about, hey, man, you know, it's college basketball season. I wanted to tease this total in this college basketball game down from 155 to 149. You know, just ridiculous. I mean, if you're teasing stuff like that, you're never going to win long term. So just stay away from stuff like that. Stay to the lower variance. The reason the NFL is so much better is these teams are more equal. In college, there's a wide disparity of teams. You know, Alabama can kick the crap out of some, you know, no-name team. And the NFL, you can only be so bad and you can only be so good. So less variance is definitely your friend.
So a perfect example of this is Sunday night, I bet the 49ers, given up the 1.5 points, and I took the under 48, I believe it was. And I lost, obviously, because the 49ers lost by 1 point. But if I would have took the teaser, I could have applied that, the 6 points, to make it 49ers plus 5 and then drop the line as well. So then I would have won my bet, correct?
Yeah, you would have won in that instance. Teasing through zero might not be the best long-term solution either because 1, 2, -1, 2, I mean, it's usually going to be 3 or more on a side. So teasing through zero is not optimal strategy. In that case, it would have won. I'd still be careful with betting teasers, especially including a total. But yes, that one would have won. And I have to say, I had the 49ers as well. They should have won that game. -3 turnover margin. Jimmy G steps out of the back of the end zone. It is what it is, but in this case, teasers can be profitable. You just got to pick your spots really carefully.
Thank you for the education. I wish you were with me in high school.
Here we go.
All right, we're going to talk some college football now. First of all, I want to thank you for James Madison, which I never would have in my life bet on that team. I was looking at the score, and I was like, ah, we're down, but whatever, can't win them all, and all of a sudden it was – the comeback was on and Appalachian State blew it. And I was like, my man, Kyle hits again, man. That stuff, I go crazy, man. Cause I love it. I absolutely love it. So good job.
That was a fun one, man. I got to give a special shout out here real quick too. Special shout out to the guy who hit me up in the DMs when they were down 28-3 saying, thanks for the loser. You know, so I sent the cash symbol back to him and then said, didn't say anything else after the game was over. But, you know,
maybe
there are
two. Maybe we can make that loser of the week when someone does that to you. You know what I mean?
Right, just post it. I mean, look, it's let's just say this. There's two halves to a football game, so it's probably not best to count something a loser in the first half.
That works with me. So last week, our boys from Ohio State, they put a beat down on Wisconsin despite Braylon Allen's 165 yards, but he probably needed 400 more to hang with the OSU with CJ Stroud with 5 touchdowns. And OSU's hitting Rutgers this week. What are you expecting?
Yeah, I'm going to be at this game. I expect Ohio State to roll here in this one. Shiano coming back to face the Buckeyes. I think this is the Rutgers team that plays really hard. They'll try to pull out all the stops. but they're just so outmanned when it comes to talent in this one. And I will say too, Braylon Allen ran for a lot of those yards for Wisconsin in the fourth quarter after the game was really already decided. You know, that's kind of that garbage time where Braylon Allen busts a couple really long runs and it's like, oh, it looks like they had amazing success on offense, but you know, they really didn't when it mattered too much. And it hurts them a lot that they have Mertz because he's a weakness at quarterback. But Ohio State's offense was clicking on all cylinders. When they look that good, man, they're going to be really tough to stop. C.J. Stroud's the real deal. Travion Henderson, Mayan Williams, great tandem there in the backfield. And I mean, nobody has better receivers than Ohio State in the country. They're consistently so good receivers-wise. Right now, the Betfred line on this one, as we record here on Wednesday night, is Ohio State minus 40.5, a total of 59. I mean, I think that tells you quite a bit, right? You know, they're favored by 40.5, and the total is 59. So they're not thinking Rutgers is going to score very many points in this one. It's going to be a blowout. I think that's probably about right. I really don't want to bet this game. I've told you before, I don't love betting Ohio State games either. I think laying 40.5 points is something that I'm almost allergic to just because it's just so ridiculous to be betting on whether, you know, they're going to let the other team score at the end of the game or not. But I don't know why you'd want to bet on Rutgers in this one either.
All right. What about the Bearcats last week? They played Indiana. They won 45-24. I'll tell you, I'm loving that. Ben Bryant, man, that guy is a big dude, 6'3", 220. His deep ball, it looked beautiful.
You know, I think Bryant's played better than expected so far this year. I also think Gino Gadulli's offense, the new offensive coordinator there, has been set up really well for him to have success. I don't know that he's a NFL star or anything like that, maybe a guy that could make an NFL team, but Cincinnati's offense has been really good. They're also playing quicker than I expected. I see this total coming in at 58.5 here. I'm going to lean to the over in this one. Pay attention, though. Tulsa's quarterback, Davis Brand, got injured last game. So I don't want to make a bet on this one until I know whether Davis Brand is going to play. He got injured last game against Ole Miss, and Tulsa's backup did not look good. So we want to know who's playing here in this one. The line being Cincy minus 9.5, I think implies that Davis Brand will probably play in this game. If he does, I think that total might be a little bit too low. Tulsa plays quickly, not a very good defense. Cincinnati doesn't have the defense they had last year, but this offense is humming along pretty nicely. So I'm interested in an over. I'm going to keep my eye on this one as we get closer to the contest.
Well, since you brought up Ole Miss there, they're playing Kentucky, a battle of two undefeated SEC teams. What are you expecting there?
Yeah, I didn't know I was segueing right into that, but I guess I did. Kentucky, a team that, you know, probably a lot of our viewers would be fans of Kentucky as well. Kentucky's been a fun team. You know, they have really done a good job under Stoops. I think he's done a great job with this program. This Kentucky program was way, way out of it in football every single year for year after year. Now Stoops has really done a great job with them, having them be a very solid team. They went down to the swamp and beat the Gators. They haven't played a tough schedule. They've played the 88th toughest schedule so far this year, according to Sagarin. Ole Miss has only played the 102nd toughest schedule too, though. So two teams that really haven't played a tough schedule. We have a live line here. Ole Miss minus 7. I think that's interesting, Bengals genius, because you've got 7th is Kentucky in the rankings, the AP rankings, and now they're getting 7 points at Ole Miss. I always say, though, you got to be careful with this because the average bettor, the Joe Public bettor, is going to say, oh, Kentucky's the 7th best team in the country and they're getting 7 points. I automatically have to take that. Long term, that's actually lost, you know, to doing that kind of thing. You know, taking the higher ranked team getting points has lost against the spread more often than it has won, because the odds makers know what they're doing. You know, let's be honest, you know, it's tough to beat the odds makers. So just looking at a ranking from the AP and trying to bet on a game is not the way I'd go about it. I would say, Ole Miss, I've been riding unders with this team quite a bit for a while, but this total at 54, I think, is a bit too low for me to take an under. Ole Miss does play really fast. One thing I wanted to point out for people real quick, Jackson Dart, a cool name too, by the way, for Ole Miss. His average depth of target is almost 14 yards. Now, normally it's somewhere about 8 or 9 yards. This Dart, he just goes, lets it fly. He's letting it rip way downfield consistently, not really completing very many of them, but he is letting it fly. But that's kind of opening up the run game for them. Ole Miss is tremendous in the run game. So Cincy Kentucky is going to need to be able to stop the run if they want to win this game, because that's going to be a big key here. Ole Miss wants to show them that deep ball so that they can run against them. I think this is going to be a fantastic game. Chris Rodriguez back for Kentucky. He's been out for a little while here. He's a star running back. So I think this is a really good game. Not one that I particularly want to bet on, but I think it's one where if you're a sports bettor, you can learn something by watching these games as well. So you can file this away for future so that maybe you can make something on the next game.
So this is an educational game.
There you go. Yeah. We're all about education here.
All right. Last one is Michigan, Iowa. I thought Michigan looked like they were completely looking ahead to Iowa playing against Maryland. I was surprised how Maryland hung around so much with them. But who do you like in this one?
Michigan laying 11 here at Betfred on this one, and a total of 42. Michigan ran up the score last year in the Big Ten title game on Iowa. I've been reading some of the quotes from the Iowa players here going into this one. They didn't appreciate that very much. That was I don't know if you remember that game very well, but they got in the Big Ten title game. They're up 21-3 with 11 minutes left. Michigan scores 21 more points in the last 11 minutes. I remember them calling a trick play with like a 35-point lead or something right at the end of the game. Harbaugh's just running up the score. Kirk Ferentz in Iowa, not a big fan of that. So, look, Iowa's offense sucks. There is no way to say it any other than that. They're really bad. But the defense for Iowa is really good. I think Iowa's defense will come ready to play in this game. I would expect a really strong effort from this Iowa defense that was kind of embarrassed in that game. Michigan played that tight game last week. Before that, who did they play? I mean, they really hadn't played anybody. The schedule had been extremely weak so far this year, just a bunch of nobodies. 11 points, a lot of points, playing at Kinnick Stadium in front of a fired up crowd. It's going to be super ugly. I mean, this type of game is super ugly. If you want a bunch of points and, you know, back and forth action, this ain't the game for you. But I'm going to take, for my free play in this one, I'm going to take Iowa plus 11. I think they can ugly this game up enough, make it low scoring to hang around here against Michigan after they were just embarrassed last year.
This does seem like one of those games where Michigan could easily lose or at the bare minimum not cover.
Yeah, I think Michigan probably will win. I mean, but this being a tight, low-scoring game is what I'm looking for here in this one.
All right, man. Ready to rock.
1, 2, 3, let's go! Little mama, show me how you're moving. Go ahead, put your back into it. Do your thing like it ain't meant to win. Shit.
Okay, time for three picks that are more than just Ohio sports. We're going to look everywhere, up and down, nationally. What do you got, Kyle?
All right, first up for me this week, we talked about teasers. I'm going to give my first play on a teaser here, a two-team six-point teaser in the NFL. Here's one for this weekend. I like the Bears up from +3 to +9 against the Giants. Low-scoring game. Those points are crucial. Second, I'll take the Titans up from 3.5 up to 9.5 against the Colts. I think a total of 42.5, 43 there. So two low scoring games. I'm going to take those teams to get above the 7 in what I think could be two ugly games. So that's my first one. Second play, Cal and Washington State over 53.5 in the Pac-12. Both these teams are improved on offense. The total is pretty low for Washington State standards, airing it out with Cam Ward. So I'm going to take the over on that one. And then my third and my favorite of the three plays here, this one you'll be able to find boosted with the best odds at Betfred Sportsbook this weekend. I'm excited about that. LSU -9 against Auburn. The Auburn Tigers have looked completely dysfunctional this season. I mean, they got some serious problems going on. Harsin in a bad situation, LSU, the better talent team. I'm going to lay the points here with the LSU Tigers up against Auburn this weekend?
Okay, for me, it seems very common that amateur bettors fall in love with the overs when two good teams play. So Buffalo and Baltimore, I like the under 51 in that game. I think I'm taking the Jags +6.5 over the Eagles. Doug Peterson, Trevor Lawrence, I think they want to show the league that last week wasn't a fluke in San Diego, and they're really an up-and-coming team. So I like Jacksonville in that one. And before I give you my third pick, this is my third and favorite pick of the week. You can find it boosted with the best odds at Betfred Sportsbook. The Mighty Lions to keep their streak alive. The 3-0 against the spread. Take them -4 over the Seahawks. Lions are 3-0. Like I said, Dan Campbell's feeling the heat right now. They lost. It was kind of embarrassing how they lost that game last week. And anytime, you know, Seattle's going cross country, start that 1 o'clock time, I give that edge to Detroit, and Geno Smith's about maxed out. That's it for the Cincy Corner this week. Thanks for stopping by.
Don't forget to subscribe to this channel and give this a thumbs up. We appreciate all your support, and we will see you next time.